Welcome today to the ministry of Jesus. This is not my ministry. I did not start this ministry. Jesus started this ministry some 2,000 years ago. I was nothing when Jesus found me, and I am more than nothing today. This is the ministry of Jesus, and he must receive all the praise, all the glory. I come to you in the mighty name of Jesus, Son of the living God.
Somebody cares, somebody loves you, somebody cares, Jesus loves you.
I've got a message that the Holy Ghost burned in my heart. One thing thou lackest, one thing thou lackest. And God took me through the Word of God, and he showed me so much. He taught me so much, and I praise his holy name for it. I give him all the praise and all the glory. You know, Jesus made a cry one day, and he said, "When I come, will I find faith on the earth? Will I find faith on the earth?" See, Jesus was looking forward into the future, and he realized that there was coming a day when there would be a great falling away. And the Bible teaches that there would be a great falling away right before Jesus comes, and the man of sin is going to take his place, and he's going to make his appearance, and he's going to take over, and we're right at the threshold for the Antichrist to take over right now. We can see it all around us. There's so much hate, and there's so much rebellion, and you can see it with the mask and everything. People were upset if you don't wear the mask, and people were upset if you do wear the mask, and people are fighting against this and fighting against that, and even the children of God, the devil's tricking them, and they're getting caught up in this escapade, and they're getting caught up in this thing that they want to stand up for, but they're forgetting about God, and they're forgetting about Jesus, and the devil loves it. He wants to distract you and get your mind off the soon coming of the Lord, and he wants you to be looking around at everything so that you're not looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith. And Jesus said, "When I come back, will I find faith on the earth? Will I find faith on the earth?" That means there'll be very little. There'll be very little, or he wouldn't have said it like that. Will there be faith? Will there be faith? And you know what? Most of the people in the United States and throughout the world, they think that faith is just believing in Jesus. I got news for you. Faith has nothing to do with believing in Jesus. The devil believes in Jesus with fear and trembling, the Bible says. And that has nothing to do with this. This faith that we're talking about is not just believing. This faith, the Bible says, operates through love. It's working through love. It works through love. One thing thou lackest. One thing thou lackest. Throughout the Old Testament, God prophesied that there would come a time that the Spirit of God would be outpoured like great rivers, that it would first be to our ankles, and then it would come up to our knees, and then it would come up to our waist, and God would outpour his Spirit, and God wants to do that. He's been longing to do that, and now the time is getting close that God is going to do that. He hasn't been able to do that. I know the Christians have been saying that the Spirit of God is being outpoured, but there's been a great falling away, and the Bible says there'll be a falling away, and then the man of sin will be revealed. They're butted right up against each other, and the only thing that separates them is a comma, and that comma is the coming of the Lord. And I'm telling you, the great falling away is now here, and it started back in 62. There was a great falling away in our country, because did you know that this month is the month that celebrates for Lucifer, when prayer was taken out of our schools? It happened in 62, in this very month, and prayer was taken out, and people were wondering why all these kids are being killed, and they're wondering why the devil's coming into the schools and killing the little kids. It's because Jesus is not allowed in the schools. They've not allowed him in there, and we were growing up now with a generation that, the devil prophesied about them. I mean, Jesus prophesied about them in the Word of God, and he said that they would be despisers of those that do good. They would be heady, and they would be high-minded, and they would be lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. And we're in that generation right now. They hate the things of God. They hate morality, and they take great pride and great joy in standing up against things that are right, and they want to show things that are wrong, and they boldly do it, and they portray themselves. That's the generation that's on the face of the earth right now. And I'm telling you, Lucifer is about to take over through the Antichrist. The coming of the Lord is nigh. The coming of the Lord is nigh. But God God has got to outpour His Spirit first, and He can't right now because there's been such a falling away. Will I find faith? Will I find that type of faith that operates with love? The love of God will anoint you to not only believe the Word of God, but to act it out. To act it out and let the Word of God take you over and possess you. It's love. It's love. It's love. And the church has lost their first love. That was the accusation in the Word of God. Thou hast left thy first love. And so many people, oh, they claim to be living for Jesus. And they claim nowadays, it's a common gospel that's going around now, that we, oh, it's not by works, it's by grace. It's by grace, it's by grace. But the Word of God plainly says that without faith, works is dead. Works is dead. And in the one of the writers said, do you think your faith will save you? It won't save you. No, it takes works. If John the Baptist was here right now, ooh, I could hear him talking right now. He said, don't think that just because you're a Christian, you're going to go to heaven. God can raise up stones and turn them into Christians. It's time for the axe to be laid under the root of the trees. And it's time for those that aren't producing the right fruit to be hewn down and cast into the fire. He said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And he told the people, bring forth fruit meet for repentance. And don't just tell me you're a child of God. I want to see the difference. And we're living in an hour when they don't believe in living different. They don't believe in acting different. Oh, they believe in just saying, oh, Jesus, forgive me. Now I'm going back to Lucifer, and I'm going to continue smoking, and I'm going to continue drinking, and I'm going to continue cussing, and I'm going to make it to heaven because I prayed one day and asked Jesus into my heart. You can ask Him in your heart 24 hours around the clock, but there's one thing lacking, and until you do that one thing, Jesus will never be yours. The servant came running up to Jesus, and he bowed at Jesus. He came running after Jesus. It reminds me of the church today. Ooh, he came running, and he bowed before Jesus. Oh, yes, praise and worship is the thing now. Praise and worship is the thing now. Just praise Him. He doesn't care how you live. Oh, He understands you're only human, and you can't do any better than what you can try to do. He understands that He's a holy God and you're not holy. And that's the way this person reminded me. Oh, they came up praising God and they kneeled down and they began to tell the Lord, oh, I'm obeying the Word of God. And He said, one thing thou lackest. One thing, and this is what the Church of Jesus Christ is lacking. This is the reason why, when I'm getting ready to present to you, this is the reason why people throughout the world are on drugs and alcohol, and they're just killing themselves every single day. Every single day, people are dropping into hell. How come they're not knocking on our doors and coming running into our churches saying, I want what you have. I need what you have. It's because the churches have lacked one thing. They lack one thing. What is that one thing? Go and sell all that you have. Give away your life. Jesus said that the way is narrow. It's narrow, and few there be that find it. Jesus said, not only do you have to surrender everything, you've got to hate your father, hate your mother compared to the way you love me. And He said, even your own life, and you've got to pick up your cross and follow me. Where is the surrendering? Where is the bowing to Lord God Almighty and letting the love consume the sacrifice and taking it over? Churches don't love God. No, most of them don't. And that's why we have hypocrites. And that's why this young generation that's on the earth, they're fed up with church. And it's the preacher's fault. They're fed up with churches. They say they're full of hypocrites. And you know what? They're absolutely right. The preachers today and the people within the congregations, they live any old way they want. They do anything they want. Hey, praise God, I heard a song on TikTok a little while ago. It says, I get drunk on Saturday night and I praise the Lord on Sunday morning. And they weren't making fun. That's the way they live. And you know what it is? They're committing adultery against God. They're committing adultery against Him with Lucifer. Now Jesus came saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And the repent doesn't mean telling you're sorry. It means to turn from your sins. And I know that this is old-fashioned preaching. Yes, it goes clear back 2,000 years ago to Jesus. And it's the same Jesus. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. God wants to deliver. God wants to set free. But the preachers and those that are sitting in the congregation, one thing thou lackest. Sell all that you have. Don't you remember in the Word of God, there was a story. Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure in a field. Which when the man found, he hid that treasure and went and sold all that he had so that he could buy that treasure in that field. He also said the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant man looking for goodly pearls. And when he had found one pearl of great price, he went and sold all that he had. That is what it takes to really be a child of God. You have got to surrender your life to pick up your cross and follow Him. There's no surrendering. One thing thou lackest, you don't love God. One thing thou lackest, you did not repent and turn from your sins. One thing thou lackest, you don't care about souls dying and going to hell. One thing thou lackest, the power of the Holy Ghost. The fire of His love that will burn within your soul, that will burn within your mind, and it'll anoint you to get up in the morning. You won't read a chapter and say, God bless me today, and go on. No, you get up and you fellowship with Him. You know, the churches, people are going to churches now to get anointed and to hear the Word of God, but the anointing should be in their house so strong that they're having fellowship with God, and the Word of God should be pouring in your house, and you should be seeking the face of God and fellowshipping with Him. The Bible talks about when Jesus died, there was a veil, and it ripped from top to bottom, and the door was open into God's heart. Have you ever read that story of the Word of God about the veil? In the Old Testament, there's a type and shadow of the church. What is the church? It's you and me. It's not a building. You were to be the church that God lives in. But God had a church in the Old Testament. And there was a holy place, and then there was another place called the most holy place. And the most holy place had a curtain in front of it, and no one was allowed to go in there. They could only go in there once a year, and they had to go in with fire. They had to go in with fire. Amen. They were not allowed to go in there. And the Bible teaches when Jesus died on the cross, there was a great earthquake, and suddenly the veil was ripped from top to bottom. And God's heart was open for whosoever will let Him come. But the preachers have failed. And you know how they're going to see inside that veil? Through you as a child of God, and through the preacher as a child of God. And inside that veil is the very heart of God. Inside that veil is the great peace of God that passes all understanding. Now this is why we have Christians that are depressed on Tuesday. Oh, they went to church on Sunday, and Wednesday they're about ready to kill themselves. Thursday they're so depressed they got to take a pill. Friday they got to go to the doctors because the pill didn't work. And then they can't help nobody, and they're going through so much. And then no wonder they're like, hurry up, I got to get back to church. Yes, because there's no love. There's no love. In the love of God, in the heart of God, is everything you need. Hear me. Everything you need is in God. Everything you need is in God. He said He had peace that passeth all understanding. That means you can't even figure it out. You can't even understand it. And joy that's unspeakable. You can't even put it into words. And it's full of glory. It's full of power. The Bible says in the presence of the Lord, there is fullness of joy. And why don't those Christians have it? They don't have enough of the anointing of God in their life. And the reason why they don't is the preacher hasn't showed them. The Holy Ghost hasn't taken over the preacher to show them into the most holy place. In the New Testament, the Bible talks about the children of Israel still have that veil over their face to this day when they read the scriptures. They can't see it. And I'm telling you, the veil is over the children of God right now. There's been a great falling away. The church has become more important than God. The ministry that God called me into is nothing to me compared to God. Nothing. They care more about protecting the little lambs that are in their church, and they care more about protecting and fighting and keeping their church alive than they do keeping the fire of the Holy Ghost alive in their heart. That's what matters. The Bible says that thou shalt love your church with all your heart. No, it says thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and all thy soul and all thy mind and all thy strength. And when that happens, you'll automatically have the love for your neighbor because you won't have to muster it up. The Holy Ghost will take you over and He'll give you that love. And in this ministry, the Lord told me, now this is not my ministry, this is Jesus' ministry. The Holy Ghost let me know that He's going to rip the veil from people's eyes so that they can see God and they can see His joy, His love, and the reality of Him. And then it'll be up to them to choose whether or not they want the Lord God Almighty or not. And many people are not going to want God, but there's going to be a people that will want God. And I'm telling you right now, the drug addicts, when they hear this message, it's going to affect them. And the people that are doing all sorts of vile things and those on witchcraft, when they hear this, the Spirit of God is going to touch their heart. And I'm telling you, churches become a show, and they get dressed up and they put on their ties. And I'm not against wearing ties, but hear me. They get dressed up, they put on their ties, and they put on their suits, and they carry their Bible, and they go to church, and I love you, Jesus, amazing grace. And they praise God and worship God, but they go back to the house, and they fight with their husband, they fight with their wife, they don't pray hardly at all, they pray just enough to make them feel okay, and they go through their day, and they live their life, and they leave God away. And God has to be your life. The Bible says you're supposed to present your body as a living sacrifice unto Him. And that's not on Sunday. I believe if Jesus, when Jesus comes back, I'll bet you He's going to come back and make sure it's not on a church day. Because, oh, people want to live for God in church. And it's easy to fake it. It's easy to act all smiling and treat everybody real nice. And then you get back home and you're so stinking mad because your husband or the wife ran over something on the way and almost ruined your tire. And, you know, it just takes nothing for the devil to knock the children of God around now. But I'm telling you, there's a great falling away. And the children of God are not in love with God like they used to be. No, no, no. And in the 90s, it really started to happen. In the 90s, oh, it started to happen. I watched it just in my day. I remember when I was a little kid, they prayed in school. I was born in 61, but I still remember they kept praying in my school till I got about 5 years old, and it suddenly stopped. And I remember wondering what happened. It stopped all of a sudden. But even back then, things were more moral than they are today. Around that time, Andy Griffin was a number show in America. Can you believe that? That seems like that had to have been hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years ago. It was a different hour and a different time. But now, it's grown into a religion. Jesus has just become a religion to so many. And it's just a belief, and it's not a way of life. Jesus should be the reason why you go to bed, and He should be the reason why you get up. He should be your song throughout the day. No wonder the children of God don't pray without ceasing, and they don't meditate in the Word of God day and night. No wonder they don't have enough of the love. Remember, it's the Holy Ghost that sheds abroad the love of God in your heart. And if you don't have enough of the anointing, He cannot shed abroad the love of God in your heart. One thing thou lackest, you have not surrendered your life to Jesus Christ. If you're not living for Him 24 hours around the clock, hear me, you're not living for Jesus. You're living part-time for Jesus, and part-time won't work. And if there could be a part-time rapture, you'd go part of the way up and fall back down. You wouldn't make it. It takes everything to serve the Lord. And if you want all of God, you've got to give Him all of you. And He already gave you everything when He sent His Son Jesus to die for you. One thing thou lackest, and one thing the preachers lack. They're not on fire for God. I'll tell you what, when I was at a different church before God sent me out to this ministry, when I seen somebody walk into the church and I knew it was their first time, and especially if they weren't dressed good and they maybe didn't look good, maybe they didn't smell good, I made a beeline to that person because I knew nobody else would. God loves every soul. He loves every soul. He don't care how messed up they are. He wants to fix them. That's why He sent His Son Jesus. Jesus Himself said, I didn't come to call those that are well. I came to call those that are sick and bring them healing. But the churches, oh, they look down on somebody walking in like that. And they just don't care about souls anymore. And I've taken somebody that would come in and they wanted to get saved before. And I would have led them to the Lord but I was respecting the man of God that was there. And I'd run them to him and they didn't have time. They didn't have time. Well, I will see you another time. I know one person I talked to him about Jesus. And the Holy Ghost came upon him and convicted him so bad he didn't know what to do. He said he couldn't stop crying. He didn't even know what it was, why he couldn't stop crying. And the convicting power was on him. He didn't know what to do, so he went to the church that I attended and he sat down in the parking lot and cried and cried and cried and cried. Didn't know why he was crying. It was God was dealing with his heart. I talked to him about Jesus and suddenly the Holy Ghost had come upon him. The church just happened to be open and there were workers in there and he went in there and asked for help and they sent him away. They sent him away, but thank God he came over to my house and I led him to Jesus. The preachers don't care anymore. They're too busy. I'll never be like that. Why? Because I'm clinging on to Jesus, and Jesus ain't like that. When somebody calls me and they need help, many times I'm so busy, I'll tell church, I can't do it right now. And she'll put them on anyways. And then we pray, and then God moves. But I can't turn them down. I can't turn them down. And that's the love of God. Jesus said He would leave the 99 and go after that little lost lamb. How concerned are you about the little lost lamb that's on drugs? How concerned are you about the little lost lamb that's on alcohol? How concerned are you about the little lost lamb that's bound in witchcraft? How concerned are you about the person that cuts themselves every day because they're so unhappy and they can't find no peace and they can't find no joy? You're just going to let them die and go to hell, aren't you? Well, I'm not, because God loves them. Jesus died for them. And if they were the only person on earth, Jesus would have came just for them. He loves them, and I'm asking God to send me to them and send them to me. There's too many of them. I can't find them all, but the Holy Ghost can find them, and I'm asking Him not to let them die and go to hell. What's wrong with these preachers? They should be crying out for people. I'll tell you what, if I had a church building and drug addicts and alcoholics were not coming in there all the time, and people weren't getting saved, I'd know there's something wrong with me. We're living in an hour in churches when I come up with a gimmick of how to pull in the people. And they want to come up with a plan. And oh, we got to get more people in our church. If the preacher would get on fire, you wouldn't have to worry about it. The Holy Ghost would draw them in. He would draw them in. He would draw them in. That's what happened in Jesus' day. They flocking from city after city, different cities, and he couldn't get away. He'd get in a boat and go to the other side, and they'd figure out he was in. They'd go all the way around and meet him. And in the book of Acts, the same thing happened. The multitudes, it says daily, such as should be saved came into the kingdom. You know why it says such as should be saved? It has nothing to do with predestination. That's not of God. If you think God has predestined some people to go to hell, you need to get saved. Because God is a God of love. He's not willing that any should perish. And He said He wishes that all might come to saving grace. Amen. He wants all to be saved. That's what He wants. He's not willing that one soul would die and go to hell. And for you to say that, you don't know God's love. He burns with love. So much so that the Bible didn't say, oh, God is peace, God is joy. It says, God is love. It's the best word God could think of to describe Himself. But the churches don't have that love anymore. They don't care. They just don't care. They just don't care. They're too busy working for God to serve God. Isn't that a strange statement? Wow. Too busy. Too busy. I've got to prepare my sermons. Oh, thank God I don't have to prepare sermons. I yield to the Holy Ghost, and He's always got one ready. Oh, I just want the Holy Ghost to take me over, because He's the one that can prick a heart and make them say, I've got to get what you got. I need to get right. I'm not right. Something's missing in my life. Something's not right. Something's not right. One thing thou lack is what's wrong with the church. What's wrong with the church? What's wrong with the church? They just don't care. They're just not on fire. They don't have a burden. Every preacher should be shedding tears. Tears crying out, God send the alcoholics. God send the drug addicts. God send those that are killing themselves. And I've said before, and I'll say again, that the Surgeon General just made an announcement that suicide is at epidemic proportions right now. They're dying, they're dying, they're dying. And why are they dying? Because they have not found Jesus, and they've never seen through the veil to see the heart of God. And it's time for the children of God to take their place, so that when they walk around, God can show them within the veil. They'll see a heart that's on fire. They'll see a heart that's full of joy. Not a heart that has to take medication because they're so depressed. Now that's the hour we're living in. And that shouldn't be. The children of God should be the happiest people till they think you're crazy. They've always thought I was crazy, and that's why. Because I was always happy. I had one person tell me in the last church, he didn't tell me, he told other people. He said, I don't believe anybody can live the way Jim's living. That's fake. That's fake. Now, this was a Pentecostal church. And he fought me tooth and nail. Fought me tooth and nail. And one day he finally realized that it was real. And he grabbed me and hugged me after treating me like a dog for years. And he said, I'm sorry, I didn't know it was real. I didn't know it was real. Now that's a pitiful thing when a church can bump into a child of God that's full of God and they think they're crazy and think they lost their mind because they do not recognize the fire of God. They do not recognize the joy of God. They do not recognize the love of God. What a pitiful thing that is. That when you get on fire for God, you become the rare bird and the bird that's all messed up.
Amen.
something wrong. You should be, when you're on fire like that, the people should say, praise God, brother, you're on fire, and I can tell, get a little closer to me, I need a little bit more. And oh, hallelujah, they should be rejoicing in the Spirit of God. But instead, they look at you and say, oh, you think you're better than me. And oh, you're making me feel bad because you pray every day, and I don't really feel like praying. I don't have time, and God understands. I had one person tell me, I don't have time to spend time with God, I spend time with my family, and that's the same thing, and God understands. No, He don't. That's not true. He said in His word that He has to come before your family. Me and my brother was discussing, I think it was just yesterday, how Peter, in the Bible it talks about Peter had a wife and we don't hear a thing about her. One time she was sick and Jesus healed her. We don't hear anything about her. Why? You say, well, he got divorced? No. It's because God was the main thing in his life. And when he got around people, he wasn't talking about his wife. He was talking about the power of God. And you can be healed and Jesus is coming soon. And you need to get ready and you need to repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. What happened to the fire of God? One thing thou lackest, you have not surrendered your life to Jesus Christ. You still live your own life. That's the problem with the Christians and with the pastors. They still live their life. When they get up and they do their responsibilities before God. No, the Lord taught me a long time ago that here's what He told me. I don't want you to work for me, Jim. I want you to fall so in love with me that the love of God will take you over and do the work through me. He told me that a long time ago. And I remember when I got hired on at that church to be used in the music department. I started praying and seeking God, and I said, oh God, I'm getting ready to mix music for Him, and I'm getting ready to do this and do this. God, anoint my hands. Help me to hear music the way you want me to. Use my talents and this and that. And the Holy Ghost visited me, and He let me know why He called me into that music department. Not one thing had to do with music. He let me know I called you to bring the Jesus smile and to bring the Jesus touch. I called you to let them see my peace and my joy and my power, and let them see that there's victory in the power that's in the blood, and it's not a once in a while thing. Like at the pool of Bethesda. The Christians act like they're at the pool of Bethesda. And once in a while you might get anointed. Once in a while you might get happy. It might be on Friday. It might be on Sunday. And you might get happy. Eventually you might just accidentally hit gold. And that's wrong. The Holy Ghost is the one who sheds abroad the love of God in our hearts. The Holy Ghost is the one who produces the fruit. And you should have joy unspeakable and full of glory, I say again. What the way I'm living, you all should be living, the children of God should be living. And He called me to stir up the children of God to pray like they've never prayed before, to fast like they've never fasted before, to study the Word of God, and for God to heal their eyes, that they can see, and heal their ears, that they can hear, and help their hearts to beat more in harmony with God. Oh, to love God, one thing thou lackest. It's time to surrender. If you want this fire, if you don't you think I'm crazy? That's between you and God. But I know what I got is real, as real as real. And you can have it too if you want it. I don't care how bound you are. I don't care if you have to take drugs all day and all night. God will completely set you free. You'll never crave it again. I don't care if your whole life is wretched, ruined, and I don't care how abused you've been. Jesus loved you and He'll give you a brand new life. Hear me. He'll give you a brand new heart. He won't just change you and bless you and take you as you're crippled and help you along the way. No, He'll make you whole. Jesus has all power. And the Bible says, I am the Lord God, I change not. He's the God that made this world. He's the God that made all the animals. He made the clouds and the fishies and the sea. He made everything, and He'll give you a brand new heart right now. He'll give you a brand new life right now, but you've got to do it His way. You've got to understand, for every time you sinned against God, it was your sins that killed Jesus. You're the one that's guilty of Jesus dying on the cross. Every time you lied, every time you smoked a cigarette, every time you did something that was unlike God, Jesus had to die for it. It was your fault. You killed Jesus, and you better hear me. Jesus loves you and He wants to forgive you. But if you don't let Him forgive you, when you stand before God, you will be guilty of the blood of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. I know that this is a hard message, but God sent me to warn you, because the Antichrist is getting ready to take over. And there's the power of God is getting ready to fall like it's never fell before. But it's only going to fall on those that want it and those that can see it. Jesus talked about people not having eyes to see and ears to hear. You better make sure you're not one of them. Pray with me now. God will set you free. For those that are on drugs and alcohol, I'm going to pray for you. Now, this is devil possession. And those of you that are on it, you know exactly it is. Because you've been there. I've been there, and I know I could feel the demons manifesting and moving in me when I was in sin. God will set you completely free if you meet Him. Raise your hand toward God, not toward me. You're not going to put your hand against mine as a point of contact. You're going to put your hands in the hands of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Raise your hands toward God and forget about me and get your mind on God, and I'm going to come against those devils and Jesus will set you free just as sure as He did me. I was on drugs and alcohol. You need to go back and listen to my testimony. It's on our YouTube channel. Oh God, I bring these people before You. I bring those that God are bound and they're taking drugs and they're on alcohol. Some of them are cutters, God, and they keep cutting themselves and they're so unhappy. And God, their life stinks and they know that something's missing and many of them want to kill themselves. But God, You brought them to this broadcast because You're giving them a chance. Oh God, You're giving them a chance. You're letting them know right now that they can have a brand new life and a brand new heart. And God, I warn them that if they kill themselves, they will die and go to hell and scream the screams of the damned in the flames of hell, and they would do anything to get back out and be in the torment they're in right now. That's how terrible hell is. And oh God, I pray for them, those that's in witchcraft, those that's bound with anything. I come against all the powers of darkness that have ruined your life and have destroyed your life and have kept you from coming to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I come against every one of you devils, and I command you in the name of Jesus Christ, come out! Now, God did it. If you believed, God did it. You felt that power, and I certainly felt it. Now you can get Jesus in your heart, and you can have a brand new heart and a brand new life. Pray this prayer, mean it with all your heart. Say, oh God, I'm so sorry for everything I did wrong. I know there's power in the blood of Jesus to wash away all my sins. Forgive me, Jesus. I didn't understand. I'm so sorry. I give my heart to You. Wash away all my sins. Give me a brand new heart. Right now. Come into my heart, Jesus. Come in, Jesus, right now. Hallelujah. I believe I have You, and I know I have You, Jesus. I know I have You. Yes, 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 yes. And now I want to pray for those of you that are children of God and those of you that are pastors. And there'll be people listening from all different continents on this. Now, Pastor, God has pinned you against the wall today. And He's let you know that the reason why they ain't flocking your church is because you're not on fire for God. And you need to humble yourself. And you don't listen to me. I'm bringing you the word of the living God. You need to fall down on your hands and knees and say, God, I need to repent. God, I need to get on fire for You so that people can come to Jesus. And I have not been an example. I've only been a person walking around religious. Now it's time to surrender. And all you children of God, Jesus is coming. And we need the power of God. We need the fire of God. And we're going to surrender now. We're all going to surrender our lives completely to God like we've never surrendered our lives before. Are you ready? Pray along with me and mean it with all your heart. But everybody pray in your own way. I'm going to surrender every particle to Jesus. And you better do the same thing. Oh God, I come. Oh God, I come. And I surrender my heart to You. I surrender my life to You. Pray in your own way. But you better call out to God and surrender your heart to Jesus. One thing thou lackest, surrender, surrender, give everything to Jesus. Oh Lord, I give everything to You. Oh Lord, I give everything to You. Oh Lord, I surrender. Help me to surrender more. Help me to fall more in love with You. Set me on fire to serve You. And God, I need more of Your power. I need more of the anointing of the Holy Ghost. God, I ask that You would outpour Your Spirit on those that are listening and those in this room. Outpour Your Holy Ghost. Fill us with Your glory. Fill us with Your power. And God, I do You moving. God, I feel You moving. Hola Bahia. Oh God, I feel You moving. The power of God is falling. The power of God is falling. The power of God is falling. Surrender. Surrender to God. He's here. He's here. Jesus is here. The power of the Holy Ghost is here. Yield to God. Yield to God. Yield to God. Cry out to Him. Tell Him you don't want to be left behind. Tell Him you want to be used by Him. Tell Him you want to be all that He wants you to be. We need Him. Oh God, I need You. God, I need Your power. God, I need Your glory. Oh Lord, we need You. Oh Lord, we need You. Oh Taking our Bible training courses, they'll change your life completely and they'll prepare you to be used by God. God needs you and He's calling to you, but you first got to surrender everything and you've got to fall in love with Him. Forget about being used by Him. Instead, fall at His feet and love Him and let His love possess you and present your body as a living sacrifice, as a sacrifice being presented to the Father, and let the fire of His love consume you, and then He will be able to use you.
We pray that the Spirit of the living God came upon you and thrilled you through and through as you listened to the message today. And if you'd like a copy of all the wonderful scriptures that the Holy Ghost used today, please email us at jimmyraymissions@gmail.com and let us know the title of today's message, and we will email it to you free of charge. We love you, and Jesus loves you even more. And always remember that somebody loves you. Jesus cares.